the absolute weight was fought among people that are really thin. Today, that's not the case. There are people of all weights and all sizes fighting. So people are preparing themselves better physically. Now, this doesn't mean that we've lost the technique. It just means that it changes the way the sport is fought. And but I think the technique is still there. I think a lot of these guys, Liborio and Mauricio, they have a technique that's still developed, but it's mixed with a larger build. And this is the difference between sport and the past.
We continue touring Rio de Janeiro. Right now we're going to go inside to see how the guys, the top line of Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, how they prepare themselves physically for championship. We're going to meet one of our best trainers, personal training, and come with me. Let's go inside. So here we are in Rio. And I'm going to introduce you one of the greatest physical trainers in Brazil. And his name is Almir. Almir. Hey,
hi. How are you?
This is one of the guys, black belt in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. Otávio. His name is Ratinho. And he's one of my best guy, was one of my instructors, and has been won many titles in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. This is Anderson Xavier, one of my best black belts, has been to school in Santa, São Paulo, Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, and right now is one of the best black belts in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu in the country, as well as a very good coach.
How do you prepare somebody in jiu-jitsu to fight in the free fight? Are there certain exercises, or how would you prepare them physically for something like that? Good. Well, we see the quality and the capacity of the student and what he can do. Then we create a series of exercises, basic exercises that work on the actual power, the force of the fighter. And then, as we get closer to the fight, we start to work on a period of exercises that work on velocity, let's say quickness. So we work on force and quickness, or velocity. Could you show us a practical example with these two athletes here? What kinds of exercises you use, let's say, to get someone prepared?
Good luck.
Fabio Curso. He's one of the fighters that I gave a black belt to. He's worked with me as an instructor. He's one of the best athletes of Jiu-Jitsu in Brazil. He's going to show us right now a sequence of exercises that are specifically for the legs, but also work with the cardiovascular system.
Now, my friends in America, I'm going to show some forms of exercise that we do to enforce the tonus, the muscular, you know, tonus of the knee, like the quads, and if somebody's hurt, for example. And I'm going to work, you know, in a specific exercise to get back and get my legs back into training, okay?
Looking for their own school. Academy was close to folding. I thought the school closing was absurd. I told Laborio how I felt during a conversation, and we decided I'd tend to the commercial aspect of the business, and he'd give classes dealing directly with the students. From there, we began giving classes all the time. We've got a great relationship with the students. When they found out we got it going again, they started coming back. There are days when we got 40 guys sweating away in here. The one thing we still don't know how to resolve is that Carlson had a huge heart. He didn't know how to make money. He gave tons of scholarships to the students. Now, with a lot of struggling, the administrative part has taken off. Although it's still difficult since students are used to signing up, suiting up, and not paying up. Other than that, the academy is carrying on. We've got a sponsor that's going to do a general reform of the academy. We're going to the World Championship. And as of the second semester, Carlson Gray will have a new face. As regards to the World Championship, what are your expectations for the academy? I think we're going to do a good job in the academy. There are a few problems, though, because there are people that don't have a lot of money, and it costs a lot of money, $100, to get into the World Championship. So we need to have sponsors, but a lot of our students don't have them. This left the academy very empty because a lot of people just didn't even get into the academy. Other than this, though, I think we're well placed. We had a meeting, and all the black belts are very ready to fight. How do you think that the loss of Carlson to Europe and many other of the best teachers to Europe and the U.S. has brought down the level of jiu-jitsu here in Brazil? Do you think that Brazil has a chance to maintain the level that we had in the past, even without these teachers? I think, yes, we are going to be able to get a good level here. It's going to get interesting right now, because when you don't have adversaries at your level, you get comfortable. The Americans are guys that find something they like, and they dedicate themselves deeply to it. They have support, and they get the best people. For example, with volleyball, they were the Olympic champions in 89. So the Americans got a taste for jiu-jitsu, and now they're making great fighters. If the Brazilians stay in this comfortable position, they're going to lose. But we do have a good group of guys these days, and they're wide awake, and they're preparing themselves as well as the Americans. Thank you a lot, and I wish you good luck. And for the people out there, they want to come and train here, the doors are open.
Thank you. Dois pontos para mim. Estou segurando a calça. Dois pontos para mim.
Bueno.
Of the academy. How do you see this? Do you think that with the departure of Carlson to the United States, it weakened the team? I tell you what, the departure of Carlson to the United States really did weaken the team. It was something negative. Now, I always competed, and after the World Championship, I had an opportunity to work directly with Jiu Jitsu. And so, at the time, Babel called me in and told me that if I didn't come and work at the academy, it was going to close, because we needed somebody from the cradle of Jiu Jitsu. At that time, we had 5 students, and now we've been able to turn everything around completely. The academy's grown a lot, and we're doing a lot of good things. A lot of changes. The support that the guys didn't have in the past, they've got now. One of the problems is that it's not enough to have just a comprehension of jiu-jitsu. Because there are a lot of guys that are good fighters, but they can't teach. And of course, there are a lot of teachers that have never been fighters. You need to understand the competition and the classroom. This is one of the keys to getting jiu-jitsu across. So I believe that are really ready to win some fights, and our work together with black belts, having black belts in the academy, has really helped the school a lot. What do you think, how do you think that you've got an opportunity to have a fight? Free fight has done good and bad, let's say. On one side, it's helped to give a name to jiu-jitsu. But on the other side, it denigrates the image of jiu-jitsu. Jiu-jitsu has a lot of different aspects to it. There's jiu-jitsu as a sport, as an Olympic sport, let's say. It helps the social level. For example, we can teach it to women, to the elderly, to children. Which isn't the same thing with the free fight. The free fight is should only be fought by black belts, by people with psychological control. But jiu-jitsu can be fought by anyone. And definitely the free fight has helped to create a market for jiu-jitsu. Okay, the U.S. is the capital of the world. It's where the huge media centers are. And this is the time. And so there are 2 segments completely distinct from each other. For this, it's important to understand that
jiu-jitsu.
How do you see jiu-jitsu in relation to the world is capable of reaching our level of jiu-jitsu? And in terms of Europe, the United States has a great advantage. They've got more support, financial support. Genetically, they have an advantage, even psychologically. But in terms of knowledge, of style, of the standard is ours. So this really comes from Brazil, and this is our advantage, even more than in Japan. The structure, formation, should come directly from here, from Rio de Janeiro, which is the nest, the source of jiu-jitsu. You agree with Murilo when he says that we are the new samurai? I believe that we are great masters, that Brazil is giving an example to to the rest of the world for how fighting should be done. And I believe that soon Jiu-Jitsu will be like soccer or samba, something very indicative of Brazil. So you think that Jiu-Jitsu at this moment is like soccer, is something national? Yes, I believe that definitely it's a characteristic, national characteristic, something that demonstrates what Brazil is. What are your expectations for the World Championship? Do you think that in terms of organization and our growth, do you think that we have a chance of doing well? There's no way that we can have the same disorganization that we had in the past. People are becoming aware of what we need, of the weaknesses in the structure and the logistics. So we're starting to be aware of these things and try to better them. I don't think we're going to go backwards. We're going forward, and everyone is aware of this. So in terms of the awareness outside of Brazil, we've got 7 Germans and 7 French people here, and it shows the difference in the formation of Jiu-Jitsu and how it's attracted people from other countries. A problem with the cost of getting into the World Championship, and this is something they need to work on. It's not just expensive here, but expensive in the exterior. I understand exactly what you're saying, and I think that we need to clear and make clear where the money is going that we're paying for the World Championship, because this could cause problems and denigrate the image of Jiu-Jitsu, not just here in Brazil, but in the rest of the world as well. You can't let this happen. I don't want to see this sport not able to become an Olympic sport. We need to show this a serious sport. And if there's not competence and honesty in the sport, no way that we're gonna keep moving forward. Certainly. Thanks a lot, and it was a pleasure. This is an honor of Tanya Martins Novo, the director of the community and the neighborhood, who helped us offer programs to the children. The team, Noble Art, honors the great master Eds and Dosanges that with tenderness and dedication taught us Professor Claudio Coelho and Fernando Hugo de the art of boxing.
É espaço de treino livre, como você está vendo. Nossos troféus ali, tá? Aquela frase ali, eu roubei da Academia do Jacaré.
The Noble Art Team, School of Champions.
Escrito na Academia do Jacaré, eu botei porque ele também é uma escola de campeões. Aqui, tem uma homenagem aqui a dos nossos assistentes também aqui, treinador, que é José Augusto dos Santos, ex-campeão.
This is in honor of José Augusto dos Santos, an ex-Brazilian champion of professional boxing.
Nós temos aqui uma homenagem especial a todos
the Academy Noble Art, in honor of the team of fighters of free fight that gave prestige to our work. As we get the name on the board and as we train them, we put their picture on the wall and list them.
Então, muita gente se sente muito importante quando chega aqui e encontra o nome na parede. Isso aí é uma maneira de agradar. Essa aqui é a fotografia aí com a galera. Tá vendo? Tá ali também. As viagens. Tá? Aqui, já que ele tá insistindo nisso aqui.
Here is the Professor Claudio Gomez, me, as I travel around the world meeting teams in different countries, and here's where I converted to Muslimism.
Professor Claudio.
on top of a camel.
Professor Carlos Coelho com Renzo Grace in New Jersey.
Here I am in New Jersey.
Passando para as costas do campeão do melhor do mundo. Você já imaginou o que é isso? Passando para as costas do melhor do mundo. Está aqui, ó, com o professor Jacaré. Momento também muito importante para mim, olha só. Tá vendo? Isso aí, por aí a gente vai indo com esse nosso trabalho humilde, a gente chegando junto. Eu gostaria também que vocês dessem uma palhinha nisso aqui para os americanos verem. Olha a Nari Tyson e o marido e o professor. Agora, olha a pala de coxa para os americanos. Olha que pala de coxa, coxa, entendeu? Muito bonita, né? Isso aí. E é isso aí, galera, isso é nobre arte. Gostaria aqui, juntamente com o professor Jacaré e com o meu pessoal aqui, agradecer essa reportagem. Essa gente foi muito importante. Um abraço aí, galera.
Vai,
aí. Quem quiser conhecer a Nobre Arte, faz um contato com o professor de Jacaré, que nossas portas estão abertas.
Como tá a tua equipe?
How's your team?
Para esse campeonato mundial?
Are you prepared for this world championship? I hope so. I think they're well trained. Unfortunately, I can't compete because I had a lesion. But the rest of the team is well, and I've had a lot of people getting into black belt and getting to that level, and it's going to be very competitive. I'm really upset that I can't compete in the fight as well. What's your expectations for the future? What do you expect to do? And compete to my maximum level? Until I'm an old man, I think. I want to do jiu-jitsu, kimono still, but the free fight is what gives me more money, and I need to still do that, and I enjoy it. And I also want to give to my students everything that I've gotten from practicing and participating in these sports. I want to help also to organize jiu-jitsu ever more, because I would like to see it reach more levels and reach more people. And like I said, get to the Olympics one day and be recognized worldwide as a valid sport. Thanks a lot, Grilo. Murilo. I really like to fight against Coleman. It was his dream to fight against Coleman. And he told me, I've got a way to beat him. And he challenged him during a fight in Sao Paulo, called us up, and I brought him the challenge to Coleman. And there was a spectacle in Sao Paulo, a huge fight. Kenzo is a man who's very balanced mentally. I believe in him. Ralphie, whether it's in his same weight or whatever, he's not going to fight any less than 5 minutes. We were just in the United States. We went there the 21st. And Carlos Gracie to an academy in the United States as well. I believe that soon we'll be fighting there as well. I wish a lot of success to you and to your children. And I find you to be a great mentor to the world of jiu-jitsu. We owe a lot to you as well. To your team, a fantastic team. And to your humanity, to your brotherhood. Good luck to you and for your travel to the United States. And I believe that jiu-jitsu encounters more people like you. It will become a well-recognized sport more than it is today.
What do you think,
one of the most important fighters in the sport of jiu-jitsu, one of the most technical fighters in the sport, a woman who's done lots of work. How do you see jiu-jitsu in the world, and how do you? And tell me a little bit about your work.
Jiu-jitsu work under difficult conditions. We are really just beginning, and we don't have a lot of incentives, so it's quite a challenge. Jiu-jitsu is growing a lot, as well as the participation of women.
Did you feel frustrated with the lack of women at the World Championship?
I feel frustrated, but the president must know what he's doing. I hope next year things will change.
How do you see jiu-jitsu in terms of world expansion? How do you see the expansion of the sport?
Jiu-jitsu is growing, but we need to be great in market to women because our work is very well.
Thanks a lot, and I hope a lot of success for you. What is your opinion about women's jiu-jitsu in Brazil? Jiu-jitsu is becoming a huge sport in the whole world, thanks to the events like this and to the spread of jiu-jitsu and the support from the exterior. But there's a lack of support, okay? A lot of these people in this country, a lot of these fighters are suffering, and specifically in the realm of women's jiu-jitsu. So we need a lot of incentive. There are a few women today. Hopefully in the future there will be a lot of them. Thank you. Federation of Jiu-Jitsu. guys to develop and enforce rules, standards, and unify philosophy. Once we attain a complete unification of ideals and so forth, we will attempt to become part of the Olympic competition. How do you see jiu-jitsu in terms of the free fight? Do they seem to benefit one another? With Royce's victories in the free fight, jiu-jitsu was launched internationally. This demonstrated that even a small proportioned individual could defeat athletes of Olympic stature, but without injuring the person, without massacring the other individual. After this, the rest of the world wanted to know the technique responsible for it. However, the pure spirit of jiu-jitsu is a realm apart. It can definitely help one succeed in the free fight, but it isn't inseparable from it. It has its own parameters. So from here, what we need to do is to get this idea out to the rest of the world. People need to know that jiu-jitsu is a serious sport, it's a martial art, and it deserves respect. You are the person who's really responsible for training Henzo and giving him incentive. You perfected his fight. Do you think he has the capacity, even with his small build, to fight against such names as Tom Edson, Wesley, or Coleman, people who are wrestlers? And do you think he has the capacity to defeat these fighters? We didn't get into the free fight because we were attracted to the violence. We got into it because we wanted to show that jiu-jitsu was an art that was not only beautiful, but practical. A practical way to bring down an opponent. It could be used in real life situations as an effective form of defense. Today, sure enough, it's recognized in the world as a martial art deserving respect. Now, in jiu-jitsu, we have categories that put the right-sized people together. Now, we say we have a small guy who knows jiu-jitsu and a big guy who doesn't. I'll bet on the small guy. But, as we see it today, everybody is learning jiu-jitsu. This means a small guy is going to have different odds. What we really need is to enact weight categories in the free fight. This would balance the scale. In terms of Henzo against Coleman, it's difficult to know. Coleman's a big fighter. He's got experience. He knows jiu-jitsu. But Henzo is studying wrestling, finding out what the wrestlers think. He's a dangerous fighter, an opportunist. So what I'm trying to say is that it's difficult to tell who's going to win, but I think Henzo is pretty well prepared, and I think he's got a good chance of beating him.
I'm here with Bad Boy, which is a mark of clothing that sponsors a lot of fighters here in Brazil, including one of the world champions who is being sent now to the United States. Monica, how do you see the development of jiu-jitsu here in Brazil, and what do you think are the possibilities of Bad Boy sponsoring a world championship on an international level, either here or in the exterior? Actually, Bad Boy is, at the moment, sponsoring fighters not just here in Brazil, but in the exterior. And I think this is very important. I think it's important to incentivate fighters because it raises the level of jiu-jitsu in the country, and that to me is very important. But who are the most important athletes right now that you're sponsoring? Some of the fighters we're sponsoring right now in Brazil: Carino, Roleta, Mauricio, Malibu, as well as in the free fight, for example, Victor Belfort, Marco. some foreigners as well.